Polanski, a renowned film producer, director,
God, that sounds about right.
An actor who fled the U.S. after pleading guilty to intercourse with a minor. Alcala was
later... But not after winning an Oscar for it and receiving a standing applause and people lamenting the fact that he couldn't be there because he was on the run for fucking raping a kid. Hollywood is sick, man. Hollywood's fucking sick. And, yeah, and he is still praised to this day. That Polanski shit, man.
Later convicted of the rape in 1970, but only served 34 months in jail for defiling a minor, as Shapiro's parents didn't want her testifying at the trial for rape. Fast forwarding to 1980, he was convicted of murdering Robin Samso, a 12-year-old.
Davis.
The conviction was overturned twice before finally getting a death sentence for her murder, and also for the and murders of Georgia Wixted, Jill Parenteau, Charlotte Lamb, and Jim Barracombe that occurred in the 1970s. It's therefore believed that between 1969 and 1980, he could have murdered a lot more people. In 2012, he confessed to the murders of Cornelia Crilly, flight attendant, and Ellen Hover, an heiress, and in 2016 got charged with murdering 28-year-old Christine Ruth Thornton. Now, knowing his story, it's disturbing that on Wednesday, September 13th, 1978, Alcala made an appearance on the TV matchmaking show, The Dating Game. Even more disturbing is that the day's bachelorette, Cheryl Bradshaw, facing the lineup of four eligible bachelors, chose Alcala, going by bachelor number one. He was introduced as a quote successful photographer and a fan of skydiving and motorcycling. During his appearance at the show, it was however confirmed that his career was typesetting at Los Angeles Times. The mention of photography was thus a curious bit because it seemed that he only used it to lure his female victims. He would then kill them and have their bodies in grotesque poses before taking pictures. An interesting bit of his appearance on the show was also the kind of answers he gave to the bachelorette. For example, he said his best time is at night because, quote, nighttime is when it really gets good, end quote. He also did an impression of a dirty old man while at it. He won the game, and with Cheryl Bradshaw, they were supposed to go on and get tennis lessons and a trip to Magic Mountain. However, Bradshaw said her intuition didn't let her. She said that while they were backstage conversing, she got extremely creepy vibes from him, and she just decided to not go with him. And she never saw him again. But that
those vibes saved her life.
Saved her life. WDBJ.
She's got a great vibe radar.
On a regular morning of August 26, 2015, 24-year-old Allison Parker, a news reporter, and 27-year-old Adam Ward, a photojournalist, both working for CBS Roanoke affiliate WDBJ-TV, were fatally shot while in the middle of a live television interview. Parker was interviewing Vicky Gardner, a director for a local chamber of commerce at Smith Mountain Lake in Moneta. At around 6:46 a.m., the gunman, Vester Lee Flanagan II, approached the trio and shot about 15 times from a Glock 19, killing Parker and Ward instantly. Gardner was hospitalized, received surgery for her wounds, and as of 2020, she said she had to come a long way in both physical and mental recovery. Flanagan II was a former journalist at WDBJ and had been fired on February 1st, 2013.
What
he had appeared
fuck?
On air at the station as Bruce Williams. In the incident video, he is shown with an outstretched arm holding the gun and firing repeatedly at Parker. Apparently, he had first hit Ward and Parker tried to run away. She was heard screaming and saying, "Oh my God," as she got shot and fell. As Ward fell, the camera momentarily captured the image of the gunman. The feed was switched quickly to the anchor at the station, who was bewildered and just said, "Okay, not sure what happened there." It was also bizarre that Flanagan had walked up to them and just stopped a few feet away, but didn't start shooting until Ward pointed the camera at Parker and Gardner. It was as if he wanted the interview to go live first. Even weirder is that he posted the whole ordeal on his social media. So, why did Flanagan do this? Well, it's evident that even WDBJ's president and general manager, Jeffrey Marks, knew Flanagan had the potential to do so because in an interview, Mark said Flanagan's name instantly came to mind when he heard about the shooting. Flanagan had left the station, quote, in a cloud, and it was because he was asked to leave and actually escorted by the police out of the station after being fired.
Mark I never heard about this
one. Was an unhappy man and was extremely difficult to work with. He'd been dismissed due to many incidents of anger, and he didn't take that well. On the alleged Flanagan Twitter account, the graphic video of the shooting was posted along with a series of tweets referencing Park and Ward. One tweet said, "Allison made racist comments," and another, "Adam went to HR on me after working with me one
what
time."
The fuck?
So it seemed there was a personal vendetta. The video posted on a social media has him uttering the word bitch before firing at Parker. Later on, at 8:23 in the morning, Flanagan II faxed ABC News a quote, note for friends and family, and then called them at 10 a.m. to confess. The authorities managed to track him down using his phone as he tried fleeing using a rented Chevrolet Sonic on the I-81 and then I-86. A trooper tried to stop him after an automatic license plate reader identified the car, but Flanagan sped off. He ran off the side of the road and struck an embankment near Markham, Virginia. He was found in the car with gunshot wounds. They airlifted him to a hospital in Falls Church, but he succumbed to the injuries and was declared dead at 1:26 p.m. Carl Walenda.
That one wasn't even long ago. I never heard of that one. Oh my god. What the fuck? So many places to stop this? Not really, man. Like, you can't just, like, arrest a guy because he's a weirdo. Like, that's a hard line to walk. But I will say, sometimes people actually just look like serial killers. Like, actually. Like, they were literally born to just be a killer. Sometimes people just have that fucking look. Sometimes you can absolutely fucking judge a book by its cover. And it especially true for fucking pedophiles, too, man. Sometimes you can just immediately look at someone and be like, that guy, he is probably a pedophile. And sure enough, sometimes, right on the money. Thanks to Prime Boston and the Bits Davis and the Reese of Azure. You guys remember, I think it was 2 years ago, there was a, I think it was a Facebook streamer, I can't remember. It was a Fortnite streamer, and it turns out he had been very inappropriate with minors. And they released his mugshot. And it was like the most stereotypical, quintessential pedophile shit ever. The guy was, I think he was, what was it, balding, green left beard, red right beard. Fuck, I can't remember. He looked like an actual goddamn fucking clown. And the big meme at the time was, it's always the person you least expect. Obviously toying around with, like, this guy actually looks like a pedophile. Show a picture. Here, I'll pull him up real quick. I think it was Facebook. Yeah, I was off. It was just different color hair, different color beard. But here, this guy. There's a tier one, Uzora from the Resub Saint. I don't know actually what happened to this story. I don't remember if he went to jail or not. Let's see. What was his? Oh, it was child rape charges too. God damn. Thanks to Resub MCR and Weedle. Thanks to Tier 1 Bup.
Performing death-defying acts is nothing new to TV, but there's always a chance that something could go wrong.
Is he one?
This is exactly good. What happened, like, to 73-year-old Carl Walenda on March 22, 1978. While walking a wire and with live television broadcast covering the act, the world watched in horror as he fell 100 feet to his death. He landed on a taxi and bounced onto the pavement. Walenda wasn't new to walking on a tightrope and already had built a great reputation as a daredevil in doing similar stunts. The German-born performer was raised in a circus family and started learning stunts as a young child. By the time he was in his teens in 1922, he started the Flying Walendas, a group that did the traveling balancing act. The group consisted of Herman, his brother, Helen Kreis, his girlfriend, later his wife, and Joseph Geiger, a friend from school. All these individuals had circus training. They toured Europe a lot in their earlier years, garnering a reputation that had them even referred to as the Great Willendas. They specialized in walking tightropes, high-wire bicycling, and the four-man pyramid act. They eventually moved to America under the wing of John Ringling, an American circus entrepreneur. Their debut in the U.S. was at Madison Square Garden in New York City, where they got a standing ovation. They got so famous so quickly that Willenda's reputation preceded him. One of their most memorable acts was a death-defying seven-person, three-tier pyramid tightrope walk, with the highest person balancing on a chair. Their success was, however, not riddled with danger. Before Carl Willenda's deadly fall, the crew had witnessed a...
Ringling was well known for all of the animals they used. They'd abuse the fuck out of them. They'd beat the shit out of all their animals. You guys don't remember that? They were the circus that made the animal acts, like, famous. They're shut down now, though. They shut them down, like, 3 or 4 years ago, I think. Somewhere in that ballpark. They've been shut down for a little bit now. Well, even before they were shut down, they had fallen into so much controversy over beating their animals, but they eventually phased out the animals in order to comply with the abuse complaints, but then they couldn't maintain any kind of profitability, so they kind of fizzled out. Here, let me see, when was it? Oh my god, they relaunched last year? What? Wait, no way. And also, I was wrong. It was only 2 years ago. October 21st. Of 2021. I forgot the date there, the most important part. It was 2021. Oh, wait. Nope. That's when they made a statement. They were on May 7th, 2017, they gave their last performance before shutting down. But then in 2021, they announced that they're going to be relaunching in 2023 without animal performances. Circuses don't need animals. What the fuck are you talking about, man? Cirque du Soleil is an incredible group, and all of theirs is human performers doing crazy stunts and shit. They even mix in, like, stories.
Their debts. For example, in 1962, at the Shrine Circus in Detroit, the seven-person pyramid collapsed after the front man
died.
Willenda's son-in-law, tightrope partner, and nephew. Willenda's son got paralyzed from the waist down, while the niece had a serious head injury. Just a year later, Willenda's sister-in-law fell to her death from a tightrope. Also, just a few years later, another son-in-law died from electrocution after grabbing a live wire while doing a stunt. It seems all these deaths were seen as less compared to the success he got. For example, setting the world high wire record by walking 1,800 feet across Kings Island. He also did a high wire walk across the Tallulah Gorge. On the day he fell to his death, he was in San Juan, Puerto Rico, for a performance to attract his audience to the Pan American Circus performance that he was to do with his 17-year-old granddaughter, Rita. The stunt was held at beachfront hotels, where a 750-foot-long cable was strung between Flamboyant Hotel and Condado Plaza Hotel.
About halfway through the wire,
he struggled against high winds and started teetering. This lasted for about 30 seconds before he fell. A local news crew, San Juan Star, was recording the performance for broadcast. Jane Baird, the reporter, said that around the midpoint, the wire was, quote, dancing underneath him. Members of his crew who were holding the guide wires yelled at him to sit, Poppy, sit. But as he tried to squat, he was blown off the wire. His death was attributed to multiple fractures and traumas. This, however, wasn't the end of his legacy, since his great-grandson, Nick Willenda, kept performing insane stunts and even went back to the same location where Willenda died just to do the same act and successfully completed.
And smarter. Nick Willenda is the guy who did the Was it the Grand Canyon? I think so. The Grand Canyon wire walk. He has safety equipment. Back in those days, they'd do it all natural. So, dude actually just went up there, no safety equipment, and fucking let it ride. Thanks to the Bits Teach On. Wasn't there a movie about this? I don't know if there was a movie about it or not. Thanks to the Reese of Huge. This is something I've said before, and it's super true. People 80, 90 years ago were literally just more talented at some of the shit we still do today. I'm going to pull something up right after this video real quick that I think is still incredibly impressive.
This video, if you guys enjoyed it, make sure to leave a like. If you guys are new to the channel, it would be awesome if you could subscribe. And I'll see you guys next time I upload.
They were called... hold on. What was the name of this group? The Barrington Sisters. Yeah. Here we go. That's what they're called. So these two sisters used to do some crazy shit. Very old school, 1948 kind of wild performance. And they're not alone, of course. I'm sure you guys know about the Cannonball, the guy who had the strongest torso of all time. He got his name Cannonball because he literally would load a cannon, shoot it at himself, and deflect the cannonball. Like, for some reason, like 80, 90 years ago, people were like extremely talented to a level that I feel like we still don't quite achieve today. Probably just because they had nothing else to do but to practice these crazy things. Like, a lot of it's just kind of silly, useless stuff, but it's still extremely impressive. So another big one is, like, circus performers from back then were doing the absolute wildest shit that most performers don't really do today. People can do this today. That's how I found them. I was watching some modern performer do this, and they were talking about how they still can't mimic what the Barrington Sisters did. This is them just still warming up. And this is just one of their performances. Wait until they start juggling full tables. Izzy Bitskin. Yeah, I just heard Izzy one. I like Izzy. Are you sure this isn't fake? It's 1940. The tables aren't fake. The tables aren't, like, full load-bearing tables. It's just full, like, size. I don't think they'd be able to juggle, like, the actual, real, full load-bearing table. That'd be a little much. And this is just one of the things they were known for back then, but they used to do some of the craziest shit. I just always liked the foot juggling thing because it's so goofy. But they did a lot of stuff. There's a lot of performers.